Well, thank you. How are we doing today? How are you doing today?
Good.
Good. Thank you for allowing me to be back. It's my privilege to be with you and to see how you are being faithful to a God who is faithful. And you're in a time of transition. We recognize that, but it's good to be together. And when things are changing all around you, you come to church and say, wow, it's good to see some faces that we know and some people that we love. And we're glad to have folks here from all over today. And thank you for this welcome. We're going to talk today from Numbers chapter 13 and 14. So if you can kind of find your way there, we'll get there in just a moment. But my question to you is, what do I do with my fear? And to our surprise, Americans have been coming into this year, 2022, with more fear than in 2021, yet we have vaccines, we've got treatments, we've got some settlement in terms of our economy, and yet folks have more fear than in 2021. So I want to ask you, what are you afraid of today? And you say, well, how long do you have? Well, just think about the top three things. For a moment, stop and think, what are the top three things that worry you most or you're most afraid of today? I have people in my family that are afraid of clowns. Can you believe that? I'm afraid of heights. I didn't used to be, but if you've fallen off a ladder or you've done something like that, you get afraid of heights. Isn't that right? I mean, as you get older, you get more afraid of heights. How many of you are afraid of snakes? See, that's why you live in Hawaii. In Hawaii, you don't have to worry about that. Although I saw a huge ball python at the zoo the other day. You know that doctors have identified 700 different phobias. Let's see how good you are on your phobias. Are you ready? Here's the first one. Germophobia. That's a fear of?
Germs.
Yeah, that's easy, isn't it? Claustrophobia. The fear of being in closed spaces. You know what I mean? How's this one? Dentophobia. Okay, you know that. I don't know that. You're afraid of going to the dentist. Ergophobia is the fear of... A lot of Americans have it now. The fear of work. I'm just kidding. I came across this one this week. Chionophobia. It's the fear of snow. That's why you live in Hawaii. It's snowing in Tennessee where I live today. Cymophobia is the fear of waves. You can't have that and live in Hawaii. Spectrophobia is the fear of mirrors. That's what you have every morning when you get up and look in the mirror. Trey gave me another one. He said, I bet you can't say it. Trey, can you say it? Okay, it's the fear of long words, and the word is so long that he can't read it and I can't pronounce it. But how many letters in there? About 100?
Like at least
30. 30 letters in that word. Okay, only thing I can say is supercalifragilisticexpialidocious. Okay, now here's the one I like most. Phobia, which is the fear of phobias. Just kidding. So they can make up all those words they want to, but the question for us as Bible believers, followers of Jesus Christ, is how do we handle our fear? Don't pretend you don't have fear. The truth is, there's a lot of fear in this room today. And just because you became a Christ follower, it did not mean that you did away with all your fears. So what I want to say today is, if you have fears, admit it. Let's get that one, Trey. He does such a great job there. Admit that you have some fears in this room this morning. We're afraid of things that we never were afraid of growing up. I mean, we're afraid of cyber attacks on our phones. We're afraid of mass and random shootings. The person who says they are never afraid is just afraid to say they're afraid. You get that? The person who says they're never afraid is just afraid to say they are afraid. And if you read the Bible, some of the great men and women of God had fear. Abraham, a great man of faith, when he was afraid, he lied about his relationship to his wife. Jonah was afraid, went in the wrong direction. Moses, who led 2 million people through the wilderness, was afraid. And he had to have his brother with him. And so this morning we acknowledge our fears, and we understand that a lot of Bible heroes had fears. And I want to just ask you again, press in a little harder, what are you afraid of today? Maybe you're afraid of declining health. If you've ever done a biopsy, you know that the time between doing the biopsy and getting the result is one of the scariest times in your life. Some of you may be afraid of making a mistake. Afraid that you're too busy to get it all done. Maybe you're too busy. Afraid of losing your financial assets. afraid of what people will think. You know, peer pressure is not just for young people. It goes with you all through your life. What do or what will people think? Fearful for your future, for your kids. Fearful of confrontation. You don't like confrontation, so you don't want to confront anything. I know people that are afraid to go to their mailbox because of what might be in the mail. And they very seldom open the email because of what might be in the email. Maybe you're afraid of being alone, afraid of following Christ, afraid of giving Jesus everything, because if you did, it would mean you have to change some things. Now right here in this room, let's be honest, there's some fear for the future of Aloha Nani. What's it going to be like in the transition? Who's the new under-shepherd going to be? And we need to embrace and do something with those fears and not let them paralyze us. You see, we have things called panic attacks, which are extreme things. I have a relative who will never drive on a highway. I know someone else who never goes round a roundabout. I went round a roundabout to get here today. But you know, those are crazy fears, but you know, doctor, they're legitimate even though they're irrational. And so we try to relabel our fears. We say, well, I'm just cautious. I like to be well prepared. I'm thoughtful. I'm wiser. But the truth is, there's a bunch of fear in a room like this morning. So let's admit it. Then let's analyze it. And I want to say to you, not all fear is bad. God gave us a healthy fear to avoid things that are going to cause us harm. In my old church, we had a tornado come through and it blew off some tiles off the roof. And so we had to get one of those blue tops. You know what a blue top is? It's what you put on temporarily until they come and fix the roof. And so I said to one of our youth, would you climb up there and put the blue top on? He's about a 17-year-old guy, cautious. Sure, I'll do it. And he puts the ladder up and he's got the top and he's going real carefully. Then all of a sudden from nowhere, and I'm kind of directing Evan on the roof, from nowhere comes his 8-year-old brother. He climbs up before we could stop him, starts running all over the roof. He said, I'm not afraid of falling off. And we're like, stop, stop, stop. Get down. If you're not afraid of falling off the roof, you shouldn't be on the roof. Because there is a healthy fear that we need to acknowledge helps us. But unhealthy fear paralyzes us. And when I get really afraid and I don't know what to do? I withdraw. I get paralyzed, I can't go forward, I can't go backwards, and I don't know what to do. It not only paralyzes us, but it preoccupies us. So some of you are struggling with this message because all you're doing is thinking about the fear. But focus on the message and the Word of God, and by the time we finish, I believe you'll have something that will help you with the preoccupation you have with your fears that bind you up, and they kind of, every time your mind shifts into neutral, you're thinking about what you're afraid of. So let's get some handles on it today. What do I do with my fear from what happened in Numbers chapter 13? This is, the book of Numbers is important. A lot of people don't read it because it's got so many numbers in the beginning. But once you get through the numbers, there's a lot of important things. There are a lot of important things. The people of Israel have been delivered from Egyptian slavery. God miraculously intervenes. He sends them out. They get to the Red Sea. There's no way back. There's no way to the side. It's wilderness. The Egyptian army are behind them. God opens the Red Sea, and almost 2 million people walk across on dry land. Wow. And then he takes them into the desert, preparing them to go into the promised land. He teaches them. He provides for them. There's a cloud going before them in the daytime. There's a pillar of fire at night. They get to Mount Sinai. He gives them the Ten Commandments. These codify the way they're going to relate to each other. They get ceremonial laws. They get the tabernacle description so they can have that sense of his presence. Now they're at Mount Sinai. They're ready to go into the promised land. Now listen carefully. It's only an 11-day journey from Mount Sinai to Kadesh Barnea, which is the southernmost entry into the promised land. How many days? 11. If you know anything about your Bible, how long did it take them to get into the promised land?
40 years.
40 years. How does an 11-day journey become a 40-year trek? Because people the people were fearful and never followed what God wanted them to do. So, in Deuteronomy chapter 1, which is actually a speech Moses makes later about what happened, chapter 1, verse 21, Moses says this: "See, the Lord your God has set the land before you. Go up, take possession as the Lord your God of your fathers has told you. Do not fear or be dismayed. And then you came near me and said, 'Let's send men before us that they may explore the land for us and bring us word again of the way by which we must go up and the cities into which we shall come.'" Let's explore it before we go in, okay? Verse 23, "This thing seemed good to me, and I took 12 men from you, one from each tribe, and the 12 spies were sent out by Moses with the Lord's approval to spy out the land." Remember what the result was? 12 came back. 10 said, "We cannot do it." 2 said, "We sure can." And the 2 that we remember are Joshua and Caleb, who said that we can do it. 10 were fearful. 2 were not afraid. They'd gone to the same place, they'd seen the same things, but they came back with a totally different report. And what I want to say to you today is we need to realize that fear changes our focus. When I'm afraid, I see everything I'm going through differently. In fact, let me explain. It minimizes the positive. So they come back after exploring for 40 days, and they give the report to the whole community, and they show some of the fruit they've got from the land. And in Numbers chapter 13, verse 27, and they say, "We came to a land that you sent us to," talking to Moses, "it flows with milk and honey." Now, when I was a kid, I used to think that a land that flowed with milk and honey meant in every river there was milk. And not just 2%, there was whole milk. I mean, what is a land that flows with milk? Well, it's a land that will support dairy and livestock and that is really rich for agricultural products. But it also has honey, so it's great for fruit. And they come back and say, "This land is okay, it flows with milk and honey, and this is the fruit." And stop right there, because this is what we do when we're afraid. We minimize the positive. Folks, this is not just some fruit. This is fruit like they had never seen before. Verse 23 says, "They came to the valley of Eshcol. They cut down a branch with a single cluster of grapes. The grapes were so large that it took 2 men to carry this one cluster of grapes on a pole." And even to this day, the Israeli tourism industry uses this figure for the lushness and the beauty of the land and says, "Come to Israel and see what we have here." And they saw grapes that big. I went to Walmart and I picked up some grapes the other day. I could have lifted up a bag of grapes with my pinky. Can you imagine coming in and there's Greg on one end and Steve on the other end, and there's this big bar of grapes and it's actually bending the piece of wood? What we do when we are fearful is we minimize the positive. And we always have the next word, which is in verse 28, "However." You know, it's a great place, but if you find yourself doing a lot of buts, maybe you're struggling with fear this morning. And the but is, "The people who dwell in the land are strong, the cities are fortified, they're very large. And besides, we saw the descendants of Anak there, and they're really tall dudes." And when we're fearful, we don't appreciate our blessings like we used to. And all we can focus is on our fears, and we minimize the positive and we magnify the negative. Look at what these 10 fearful spies said. They said that everybody who lived there was tall. Folks, not everybody was tall, but they could only talk about the tall people. And they said they're powerful, they're like giants. And then in Deuteronomy chapter 1 and verse 28, Moses says, "You know, when you came back, you said these cities had walls around them, and they were so high they went all the way up to up into the sky." Folks, they didn't go that high. But when I'm afraid, everything looks bigger, everything looks taller, everything looks more difficult, and that's the report they gave. Caleb in verse 30 of Numbers 13 says, wait, we can go, let's go and take the land. We can certainly conquer it. But then the men, verse 31, who had gone up with him said, we are not able to go up against the people. They're stronger than we are. So they brought to the people of Israel a bad report, a negative report of the land they had spied on, saying, the land through which we have gone to spy out is a land that devours its inhabitants. It's going to eat us. That wasn't true. And all the people that we saw were of great height. And then verse 33, that famous verse, they're like giants and we are like... How many legs do grasshoppers have?
Six.
Six, not two. I mean, fear makes us magnify the negative. So when I'm afraid of, and I, you know, my health is declining, then anything I get that happens to me, I say, I gotta go to the doctor. I gotta find a pill. The tiniest twinge or pain, I need surgery. When I've lost some money, then I'm afraid of every time the Dow goes up and down, you know. If you notice, they only tell you when the Dow goes down because that's what sells. Fear sells. Positive things do not sell on the internet, on YouTube, or on the news. If you're fearful, one negative comment makes you say, everybody's saying it. I heard someone say, and everybody's saying, if you're fearful, you think nothing will work. You have one bad week of sales, and you say, well, all of 2022 is going to be off. If you've got one bad kid in your classroom, you say, all these kids are going to be terrible this year. One mistake and you want to give up, because fear magnifies the negative, and fearful people are always negative. So let me ask you this. Are you becoming more negative because our society is becoming more negative? Do you find yourself talking about the glass being half empty instead of what? Half full, it's the same glass. See, fear changes my focus and it makes me minimize the positive and maximize the negative. And here's what's so bad about it. It infects everybody around us. If your spouse is negative and fearful right now, it has the potential to affect you or your kids. If they're negative, it has the potential to affect you. It's like a virus. It's catching. Look at Numbers chapter 14. If you've got it, say, I got it. Numbers 14, verse 1. Then all the congregation raised a loud voice after 10 men gave a negative report, and they cried all night long. That's how infectious fear is. And then all the people, verse 2, of Israel grumbled against who? Moses and Aaron. Fear makes us grumble. You find yourself grumpy? Maybe you're fearful. And then fear makes us lose our perspective. Look at verse 3. The whole congregation said to them, would that we had died in the land of Egypt. That's crazy. Would that we died in the wilderness. Why is the Lord bringing us into this land to fall by the sword? Our wives and our little ones will become prey. Would it not have been better for us to go back to Egypt? Folks, fear makes us say things we don't mean. And it makes everything in the past look greater than it really was. And fear makes us ungrateful. After all God has done for the people of Israel, they want to go back to Egypt. And fear makes us take matters into our own hands. Look at verse 4. And they said to one another, let's choose a new leader and go back to Egypt. If you're fearful, you might choose the wrong leader because you get ahead of God. Or if you're fearful, you might choose the wrong leader because you get behind God. So fear is infectious. If you live with fearful people, you're likely more fearful. If you expose yourself to the news 24/7, you're going to be really afraid. If you're always on the internet or on some radio talk show program, you'll always be afraid. But if you focus on God and His Word, you'll find your fear diminishes. So what do I do with my fears? I must maintain my focus on the L-O-R-D. And if you've got an ESV, which is what you're used to, one of the great things about it is every time you get the word Lord, and it's the word Yahweh, it's spelled in capital letters. And that's the word that when they were reading the Old Testament scriptures, and they came to that, the rabbi would go, he couldn't say that word, it was too holy. And it was just consonants. They didn't even put vowels on it until thousands of years later. It's such a holy word, but it's the word for the Lord God Almighty, Jehovah-keeping God, covenant-keeping God, and we must maintain our focus on the Lord. Look at Numbers 14, verse 6. Joshua the son of Nun and Caleb the son of Jehunneh, who were among those who scattered out their land, they tore their clothes. They said to the entire community, "The land we passed through and explored is an extremely good land, but if the Lord," and this is in verse, it's not coming out on the slide there, "but if the Lord," that's in verse 8, "is pleased with us," if Yahweh is pleased with us, "He'll bring us into the land, a land flowing with milk and honey, and he's the one that's going to give it to us." This is a matter of focus and faith. Only verse 9, "Do not rebel against the L-O-R-D," that's the Lord, "and don't be afraid of the people in the land who will devour them. Their protection has been removed from them, and the L-O-R-D is with us," Yahweh is with us. "Do not be afraid of them." Truth be told, in this room this morning, and I'm included, there are times when my fear takes my focus off the Lord. Amen? And that's when I start making mistakes. And I'm going to maintain my focus on Him and what He has done. Think about all the things He's done for you, all the things He's done for the people of Israel, parting the Red Sea and bringing them here to where they were. And that's why in Deuteronomy chapter 1, that speech that Moses makes, he said to them in verse 29, "Then I said to you, do not be in dread or afraid of them. The Lord your God who goes before you will himself fight for you." If you're doing it on your own, you're always going to be afraid. He's going to fight for you just as he did for you in Egypt before your eyes and in the wilderness where you've seen the Lord your God carry you as a man carries his son all the way that you went until this very place. Any of you get here this morning without the Lord carrying you? He's carried you all the way to where you're sitting right now. I went to the zoo, and you have a great zoo here. And I was watching as, you know, people walked around the zoo, and there was one couple that came along, a tall guy, and they had one push chair, and it had a place for two kids, but one kid was riding in the front, and the other kid was on his dad's shoulders. I thought, that's a beautiful picture of how God carries us. And you know, you remember when your dad used to pick you up and put him on your shoulders? You've got too big for that now, but then I heard them as they got closer, and here was the conversation. It wasn't quite shut up, it was close to, "Hush! We're all tired, and we're going to go home, and we're not going to stay any longer." And the guy said, "But I want to see another bird or another..." "No, we're going to go home." And I'm thinking to myself, oh no. Here's how a human dad who did a good job, had a son on his shoulder, he gets tired. He gets hot. He's like, "Let's turn around and go back." But Almighty God, who's carried you this far and brought you to where you are in that seat today, He's going to keep carrying you no matter what you do. He's never going to get tired. He's never going to get weary. He's not going to say it's too hot. He's not going to say, "Let's turn back." He's always saying, "Let's go forward." And when I focus on what God has done, my fear begins to go down. And then I must focus on who He is. Let me remind you that He's Elohim, He's God the Creator. He made everything. He's El Roy, He's the God who sees ahead. You don't see ahead. We think we do, but we can't. He's El Shaddai, He's Almighty, He can do what we can't do. He's Jehovah Jireh, He's the God who provides. So I maintain my focus on God, what He's done, who He is, and what He's promised. Because there's a boatload of fear in this room this morning, but if I focus on what He's promised, I want to do that with you right now for just a minute. I'm going to give you some verses for when you're fearful. Now you can write them down, or you can just listen and close your eyes, or just let them flood your heart and mind, and here they go. Isaiah 41:10. "Do not fear, I am who I am. I am Almighty God, is with you. Do not be afraid, for I am your God. I will strengthen you. I will help you. I will hold on to you with my righteous right hand." And say, yes. Psalm 27:1, the Lord is my light and my salvation, whom shall I fear? The Lord is the strength of my life, of whom shall I be afraid? These verses are worth your memorization. Psalm 34:4, I sought the Lord and he answered me and he delivered me from all my, say it, fears. New Testament, Romans 8:15, for you did not receive a spirit of slavery to fall back into fear, but you received the spirit of adoption. We are adopted into his family, and therefore we cry, Abba, Father. 2 Timothy 1 and 7, for God has not given us a spirit of fear, but a spirit of power and love and a sound mind. How many times have you said that? When you faced an exam or you were in a situation where your boss has called you into your office and you say, God, you've not given me a spirit of fear, but a spirit of power and love and a sound mind. Hebrews 13:6, therefore we may boldly say, the Lord, L-O-R-D, is my helper. I will not be afraid. What can man do to me? Maintain your focus on what he's done, who he is, what he's promised. And learn from other Christians. I look around here and I feel like I'm at home with you and I know something about your lives and how you're going through struggles that I don't know how you do it. But you're doing it with faith and with less fear than you ever thought you would have. And learn about great missionaries whose lives speak to us of how to conquer fear. We have a friend who's a missionary in Alaska. Alaskans like to come to Hawaii. You know why? Well, you should do. But this lady's name is Brenda Krim, and I talked to her for about an hour a week ago, and just asked her stories about how she's doing, and she's told us the story of being in Dead Horse, Alaska. Now, when you call a place Dead Horse, it's not a place you probably want to spend a lot of money going to. It's above the Arctic Circle, and they were up there hunting. They had to be 5 miles west of any highways to hunt. It was on the tundra, and she said, you know, I've got this Garmin GPS. I'll go out hunting on my own. She's a good shot. She went out there, found this huge bull caribou, shot him really quickly and dressed him up and sent a text to her transporter saying, well, she used this Garmin where you push a button, it gives you a location, and it sends a text saying, I'm ready, come get me. And she's got this big bull that they're going to carry back on the snowmobile or whatever. And then she saw another huge caribou come with more antlers and points than she'd ever seen before. And she's like, you know what? I see the sun going down. I got time to just get one more caribou. So she puts her garment back in her pocket and she starts to walk across the snow, hunts this other caribou, and she brings him down. Dresses him, gets ready to take him back. And she's like, ooh, the sun's going down. I better call. She reaches into her pocket to pull out her garment. And guess what? It's not there. That'll test your fear and your faith. So she's got a rifle, and I'm thinking, what are you gonna do? So it's at night, it's 17 degrees, that's less than 32. She's no way of contacting. She said, my two great fears, this is the story she told us, were the climate and panic. Now I thought it would be a grizzly. No, I can shoot a grizzly, but how do I stay alive? She said, I knew something from survival training. I had to keep walking. I was sweating all night long. I kept walking. I said, did you pray? She said, I called out to God. I said, God, I need some light. And she said, that night there was a half moon across the tundra sky. That's what God does. And then she looked at the foliage, and I don't understand it very much about it, but she said, if you look carefully at lichen, some lichen emit a natural light. You know that. But the amazing thing is that suddenly across the northern skies there was a light display of what? The northern lights. It lasted about 45 minutes. She said, I wandered around and I knew if I could find a river I'd be safe because at least I knew where the rivers flow. I said, how long did it take you to find a river? 3 hours later I found a river tributary. It wasn't the river that I had been, where we were camping at. She said, I walked up and down that river all night long, focusing on numbers and lists and scriptures I knew. I knew if for one moment I stopped thinking or stopped walking, I would be dead. And she maintained a focus on the Lord. She woke, when the dawn came and broke through the next morning, she realized she was on a tributary 2 miles from her base camp. She walked into camp and everybody was mad at her. Like, what are you doing going out on your own? But she got back to safety by focusing on the Lord God Almighty and not letting fear take over. You want to know what happened to that garment? Just before they took her out, she went back to get the second pair of antlers. And guess what? Garment, $500 garment, was sitting on the floor, on the dirt there. Maintain your focus on the Lord. That's what she did. That's what Jesus tried to teach his disciples to do. They were with him for 2 or 3 years, and yet they still struggled with this. So we're not promising you a fearless, fear-free life because you're a follower of Christ. We're saying to you, you and I can handle our fear because we have a God we can focus on, and on what he's done for us and who he is and what he promises. And Jesus had a lesson for his disciples. He taught the parable of the sower in Mark chapter 4. Go there if you will. In Mark chapter 4, an evening comes. He says, let's go across to the other side. And they give him this little boat. And Jesus must have known it because he could see everything. He knew everything. And they get into the boat. And suddenly this huge storm comes up. The storms come up very quickly on Lake Galilee. And then the water is starting to swamp into the boat. And the disciples say, help, we're going to sink. We're going to drown. And, oh, but Jesus, you're with us in the boat. So you would think if Jesus were with them in the boat, it would be absolutely clear sailing. No, it was a storm. He knew it was a storm. And what's Jesus doing in the storm? He's asleep on a cushion. Wait a minute. So the fears and the storms, the fears are going to come from the storms of life. Jesus, you're in the boat with me, but you're asleep. Don't you know, disciples, that having Jesus in the boat is enough? That's all you need to be sure of, and that's not enough for them. So they go and they woke him up and they said to him, in verse 38, teacher, don't you care that we're about to die? And he got up and he just went out there and he said, hush. Hey, you wind, you stop. And the wind stops, the waves stop. And the sea is absolutely calm. See, Jesus is with us in the boat of our lives. And sometimes we think he doesn't care because he's got it covered, but we're more worried than he is. And he says to them in verse 40, why are you fearful? And I think he's saying that to us today. Why are you afraid? Do you still have no faith? And they were so scared, they couldn't say anything else. They said among themselves, who is this that even the wind and the waves obey him? He's the God that's with you right now in your chair, at work tomorrow, by your desk, in your car, at the side of the hospital bed. He's right there with you. He never promised you a life without fear, but he promised you that he would be with you in those fearful situations. When I acknowledge his presence, it brings a security. See, we all long for security. Security is not found in this world. It's found in the presence of Jesus with us in the boat of life. And in the middle of the storm, we're safe and secure with the Lord Jesus Christ right there with us. Would you pray with me?